Good afternoon, everybody. I'd like to ask everybody to please take a seat, and we'll start this afternoon's program. Great. And before I ask Admiral Jim Stavridis to come up, I'd like to ask everybody to stand up, and we'll say the Pledge of Allegiance. Pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the Republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all. Thank you. It's now my pleasure to introduce our chair of the board, Admiral Jim Stavridis. I think most of you know Admiral Stavridis. He's currently the dean of the Fletcher School up in Tufts in Boston, and we're very fortunate that he's joined us today to give our kickoff remarks.
Pleasure to be with you. And first, I want to thank CSIS. This is such a fantastic facility. My very good friend, Dr. John Hamry, former Undersecretary of Defense, built this house. You're in Hamry's house, and it is a spectacular one, and we're proud to continue to partner with our friends here at CSIS from a USNI perspective. These annual meetings, of course, have been going on for about 140 years. It's marvelous that we can all be part of this long blue line, long Marine Corps line, long Coast Guard line, long Merchant Marine line. All of those form ones that together constitute this extraordinary U.S. Naval Institute. As I look around the world today, I am struck by how often the story that headlines the news is one that touches on, if indeed is potentially central to, the work that we do at the Naval Institute. So think about refugees streaming into Europe, across the Aegean, across from Libya through the Straits of Messina and onto the Italian Peninsula. Think about the South China Sea, where China is building islands relentlessly. Even today, we see new reports on the Scarborough Reefs. Think about Vladimir Putin's Russian military doing Top Gun-like barrel rolls over RC-135s, swerving at 30 feet past USS Donald Cook. I can tell you, truthfully, young Commander Jim Stavridis in command of USS Barry would have had a very hard time not pulling the trigger on that particular maneuver. And I say that with my tongue only slightly in cheek. I commend the captain of the good ship Cook for his or her perseverance under very challenging circumstances. So many of these events are grounded in the oceans, in the seas, and what we do. I also think about what the Marine Corps is doing around the world today. Its continuing presence today in Syria, in Iraq, in Afghanistan, where I commanded through NATO the forces there. Think about our Marines, and think about our Coast Guard operating around the world today facing the oceans, which some have described as the world's largest crime scene because of smuggling, because of the movement of illegal goods, because of the movement of contraband, of cash, of weapons, of humans moving as slaves. All of our services underpinned by the global economy, led by our merchant marine, when you put it all together, it's a very maritime world. And thus, I think our institute remains strong and central to what is occurring in the world. We'll have an opportunity momentarily to hear from our marvelous president, CEO, Pete Daly. I'll give you a preview of what he's going to tell you. This is the best year in the 140 years of the Naval Institute. I firmly believe that. And it's a tribute to his team. He would be the first to say it. But he is very much the captain of this ship. And I'm honored to sail along in his presence. And I'm going to ask for a round of applause for Pete Daly. So So lastly, I'll make a point to kind of pre-introduce our featured speaker today, which I know everyone's looking forward to, and that's Admiral Mike Rogers. I'll be back up here in a bit to introduce him formally when he arrives. But I gave you a bit of a list of some challenges in the world today, and when I think back on my time at NATO, when people would ask me what really kept me awake at night, the answer is indeed cyber. So we'll have a chance later this afternoon to hear from Mike Rogers, an extraordinary officer, but also one who understands the cyber challenges, I think, better than any other. So with that, I will say simply thank you all for coming today. We appreciate the support. I look around the room and see so many friends from so many different points in my career, all of us tied together by this extraordinary bridge, the U.S. Naval Institute. Thank you very much.
Okay, well, again, welcome. For those who don't know me, I'm Vice Admiral Pete Daly, CEO of the Naval Institute. So, good afternoon and welcome to all our directors, trustees, and members who are here with us today, and to our guests and friends of the Institute. In addition to having Admiral Stavridis as our chair here with us today, it's also a pleasure to have Gordon England, the Honorable Gordon England, who's the former Secretary of the Navy, former Under Secretary of Defense himself, here as our foundation chair. And I recognize them both. And I think we're very fortunate at this important juncture in our history to have them two, those two people, leading our two governing bodies. It's extremely important, and we thank them. Also like to thank our sponsors. We need sponsorship, and we can't have events like this without the generous support of companies like USAA, who is represented here today by Vice Admiral retired John Byrd, and Northrop Grumman, who represented by Vice Admiral retired Mark Skinner. We thank you very much. The Institute's constitution and bylaws, it's a mouthful, require a report on the Institute at the annual meeting. And as CEO, it's my honor to report that our Naval Institute is doing very well. As far as health goes, we have the finances to carry out our important mission. In 2015, we were $1.27 million to the good, which was excellent. And from a membership standpoint, for the fourth straight years, we've increased membership. And in 2015, we went back above the 50,000 mark for membership, which is just excellent. Our foundation has also achieved, for the second year in a row, exceptional results. And it's an all-time record for 2 years running. So my hat is tipped to them and all the people both in the staff and in our trustees who have made this happen. It's phenomenal. So elected for the first time, you know, one of the compulsories that we've got here is we have to give our election results. And elected for the first time is Mr. Kenny Klepper, who was previously appointed but now is elected. And he joins Admiral Sandy Winnefeld, who also joins our board for the first time. So that's excellent. And re-elected, because we do about a third of our directors each year, our General Retired John Allen, Vice Admiral Retired Dirk Debink, USNR, Lieutenant General Chip Gregson, U.S. Marine Corps Retired, and the Master Chief Petty Officer of the Coast Guard, Vince Patton, Retired. Departing the board this year were Admiral Nancy Brown, who served 6 full years on the board, and a good deal of that time was as the vice chair. She did some really important heavy lifting. And also departing are General Jim Mattis, who's completed his 2-year term this year. And I'd like to just say we thank them in the board environment, but I would like to thank them on the record in a public environment for their service to the board, which was immensely important to our success. As I mentioned, the foundation, the importance of the foundation, all our trustees are appointed, but it's important, I think, just to see their names here and appreciate who they are. And also, we want to welcome for the first time one of our newest trustee, who's Ms. Ellen Lord, who's the CEO of Textron Systems Incorporated. Ellen, we welcome you. And I'd like to take a page out of the Stavridis book and ask all our directors, trustees, editorial board members, and those who are here and those who are departing. And I want to mention first that leaving the Ed Board is Commander B.J. Armstrong, who's done exceptional work, Lieutenant Commander Scott Sherrill, also exceptional, Lieutenant Alex Smith. And I'd like to ask them all of the Ed Board trustees and directors, newly elected, current, and departing, to stand up. I appreciate that. And before we talk about the ballot results, I also want to mention that next month, leaving the Ed Board, will be Doug Dowds. And Doug Dowds, Colonel, U.S. Marine Corps, has done a superb job leading our Ed Board, again, at a tough time. And his leadership has been exceptional. And again, he's not here with us today. He's got active duty responsibilities that he had to attend to, but I want to thank him in a public setting, on the record, and give a big shout out for Doug Dowds. This, you don't need to read this because it'll make your brain explode, but there were two, I think, important initiatives on the ballot, both of which were adopted by the members. First was this small change in the mission statement. And that's been something of a hot topic in the past few years. But when the board and everyone else who contributed to the strategic plan looked at what we were doing, we felt that the international push was extremely important. And the last phrase there of our mission statement used to say, and other issues critical to national defense. And we thought national sounded too US only. And we thought that defense sounded too Department of Defense, picture the Pentagon. And we said global security more closely matched the thrust of what we're all about. So that was really the nut on the first one. And that was a 9-1 accepted by the members who voted. The bottom one really is that when we redid the Constitution and bylaws a few years ago, we made it so if you served on the board for 6 total years, You were done for life. You know, they ripped your badge off. You never got to come back. And we considered the case of like Fred Kacher. So Captain Fred Kacher is on our board, and we're very proud of that and very proud of him. But he serves now, and then, you know, 6-8 years from now, after he's done being CNO and, you know, chairman of the Joint Chiefs, we want him back. And we didn't think he should be penalized for that early board service. That's the guy you want back. So we made this change to say that if you go away for 6 years and cleanse yourself, you can come back. And it's not a lifetime ban. So that was also adopted by the members 9-1, and that's the result. So that ends the required push-ups and the compulsories, but these are great results that represent a ton of hard work on the part of the staff. And once again, I would just like to ask, we've got a lot of our staff here today, I'd like to ask Naval Institute staff members who hate this, stand up and be recognized. Okay. And now I'd like to talk a few minutes just about the strategic plan. You've all got a copy. You could take that home. There will be a quiz, but maybe you can get some highlights. Of course, we've made a lot of progress since our 2012 plan. And the fact that we really pretty much hit the 2012 objectives generated the new plan. And I know we're making progress because people used to call me up when I first took this job and say, hey, Daly, why did you take that job? And now they call me up and say, how did you get that job? And now, so now we know we're making progress in the true, inimitable naval officer grading fashion. That's how they tell you that I guess it's going better. We've got the three big groups that everybody has in their membership. We've got the boomers, we've got the millennials, we've got the Gen Xers. But the real important thing is that each one of them has distinct needs. But for all of them, we know that we need to be the intellectual heart of the profession, not just an organization. So we've adopted as our vision, giving voice to those who seek the finest, Navy, Marine Corps, and Coast Guard. So, next slide. Looking at this image, we should have the image of DFW up. Okay, good. So looking at this image, it reminds me that while proceedings is the heart of our forum, we also have other ways that we communicate. It's just a piece. And here's CNO Richardson on 7 December at the museum at one of our events. And in all of our forums, what we're going for here is to identify and tee up the right questions. Not necessarily, and we want to completely avoid advocating for a single right answer, but we really want to get at the right questions. And one of the things we've assigned ourselves in the new strategic plan is to work harder to use our board of directors, our trustees, our editorial board, and you, the membership, to get at the right issues. Because we were finding that just simply waiting for it to come to us might not happen without a little help. And I don't think I have to hit this too hard with this audience, but sometimes there's just the right person to submit that article. And, you know, that person may be pretty busy. They may need a little encouragement, and we're going to try to do more of that. We also need to increase the dare factor. And it's right on the cover of the strategic plan. And many of us have seen the movie. No, wait. We've been in the movie where some junior officer has written and submitted a not invented here idea that shows up at a completely inconvenient and annoying time. And then there's usually a group of senior officers around the table, and they're trying to decide, do we kill this guy or gal, or do we promote them? And from our point of view, is that we need the right practitioners to write on the right topics. And it's about making the best Navy, Marine Corps, Coast Guard. So do you do that by shutting up, or do you do it by encouraging debate? And I've always thought, you know, people say, especially when you get towards the end of your career, they say, would you do it again? Were you happy with the Navy as a choice? And to me, the thing that the sea services have is this culture of self-assessment. And they expect you to do the right thing until you get that phone call that says, hey, you know that thing you just did? Yeah, don't do that again. It's called control by negation, but that's how it really goes. And we need to capitalize on that in our proceedings forum and our other forums. And I can remember distinctly specific cases where four stars, after one of those discussions, like do we kill him or do we promote him, said, we can't kill him. I want that guy as my speechwriter. And I could point around the Navy to commanders' action groups and speechwriters who are all alumnus of our pages. So the idea of providing top cover is hugely, hugely important. And to that end, we've stood up 7 essay contests over the past few years to get at the debate. And I'm also pleased to announce that Huntington Ingalls has just signed up to sponsor the Coast Guard essay contest. We've been trying to bring this back, and so it's another success. And we're very grateful for the support of Huntington Ingalls, and this will be rolled out in the May issue, which will hit your P.O. box soon. So sharing the excitement, it's extremely important, and one of the best avenues for that has been USNI News. USNI News is becoming a source of sources and being carried by many major news outlets, and that is gold to us. USNI News hit the 1 million page view per month threshold yesterday for April. And I think that's just super important. And we need to continue to leverage that platform with better graphics and better videos. And we've worked, we sent a letter to each of the services and said, we would like to do an article plus video feature of deployed units, people who are gone right now. They said, we have people who came back. We have people who are about to go. We have people who are thinking about going. Nope. We want the ones that are out there doing it, because I don't think you can ever take that for granted. And I don't know how many caught the carrier air wing piece that was in USNI News this morning. So I think that was excellent work, and it's the type of work that we need to be doing more of. Few weeks ago, we did the Marine Air Ground Task Force, the MAGTAF. We're going to do Aegis Ashore. You know, Aegis, destroyer in a cornfield, basically, in Romania and Poland, who knew? The answer is not that many people. Admiral Stavridis knows, because it's in Europe. But it's not, these are the stories that need to be told. So this is the increase the understanding piece, and we'd like to get your feedback on those. So increasing engagement takes many forms. Upper left, you see Admiral Stavridis, who managed to find West Pointers at the Coast Guard Academy event that we did last fall. Upper right is our bunker burst. We had one of our challenges that we've given ourselves is to have challenge questions posed at a conference. Bring in 30 and 40-year-olds instead of 50 and 60-year-olds, and have them solve a problem and have that get up unadulterated to the top of the chain of command. And we learned a lot through that bunker burst process. It was, I'd give it a really decent grade, actually, but it was something that we're going to do more of, and we really appreciate it. And got Ellen Lord sitting here, and she helped us sponsor that, and we're super appreciative, and we're going to do it again at Next West. The lower left is a mid at the Naval Academy talking to Sergeant Woody Williams, who's a Medal of Honor recipient, and the Navy just announced that they're naming a ship after Sergeant Williams, U.S. Marine. And you know, that mid's going to say, I met that person, and I consider that important engagement. And of course, on the lower right, you've got a few of our enlisted superior performers from West. And if you didn't go to West in San Diego in February, what was exceptional was the number of uniforms that were there. There was more energy. Jay Cohen was there, and it was an excellent event. So we're committed to improving our flagship proceedings. And what you see here is the masthead and the table of contents from the edition that's coming out in just a few days. But this is the May edition. But here's some important things. Fred Rainbow is back, and we welcome Fred. We're also excited to have two Navy captains, Dave Adams and Bill Hamblett, who have committed to come aboard on the proceedings staff when they end their active duty requirement in August. Both are superb talents. I mean, these are award-winning authors who will bring a wealth also of fresh operational experience, and it's just wonderful that they've agreed to come on board. We're committed to make the content layout of proceedings more exciting with better images and more edge. And the May issue is a knockout issue. We've got book author August Cole of Ghost Ship fame. We've got Andrew Gordon of Rules of the Game fame in the magazine. We've got Captain Dale Relosh, who's the top JAG in the Navy on the China issue, writing about the things that they're doing. We've got our essay contest winners, Sean Kate and Jesse Sloman, who are the Disruption in Technology essay contest winners, and that's sponsored by Leidos. They've done a superb job. Those guys both work at, I can say it in this building maybe, CSBA. And then over on the right, We've got Commander Guy Snodgrass writing the Naval Aviation Review. And what's cool here is, again, we took a page out of the past to get it right. We used to have an active duty editor of our professional notes, and we said, why can't we do that again? And here's Guy Snodgrass, who's a little busy. He's the CO of a Hornet squadron, VFA 195, in Atsugi, Japan, and he's our professional notes editor, and he's doing a fantastic job. But it just shows you the talent that we have, the resources that we have, and the excitement we have around proceedings, because, well, it's just that important. Okay, so I'll just talk about our professional blue and gold books and our scarlet and gold books. These books are foundational to the profession, and we looked at the refresh rate on these books, and we needed to do better. And so I'm happy to report that the Blue Jackets Manual is coming out with the 25th edition, with Tom Cutler revising that book to be a little bit more than it was. We have our wheel book series. We're on our sixth wheel book, and these things are repurposed and repackaged proceedings articles, kind of like a best of. And they've been very, very popular. We stole the idea from the Harvard Press. Division Officer's Guide, we just got the latest modified transcript from our two authors who happen to be here, Admiral Stavridis and Admiral Guerrier. Coast Guardsman Manual from Jim Dolbo, updates in the fall of 17. CPO Guide, our big focus. And what's cool about the CPO Guide is that we got a Fleet Master Chief, Paul Kingsbury, to update the CPO Guide, and it's sorely needed and long overdue. Handbook for Marine NCOs. We've just got a Marine Corps Sergeant Melendi to come and sign on for that one. So serving the profession and serving individuals in the profession and helping them advance is what we're all about. And now we've caught up on the slides. Next slide. Another core part of our mission is learning from our past and preserving primary source history. And I won't do a quiz of half of you, at least, know every name up there, but just what you need to know is that we've increased the velocity and the mass of our oral history program. We had a terrific program for years with Paul Stilwell, and Paul Stilwell is still with us. But we've signed on more historians, more PhDs, and we're working on all these oral histories and more. But it's just, I guess I can relate this without, you know, betraying a confidence, but one of the flag officers said, well, you know, I don't know if I want to do this, and what's the, you know, is it really important? And I said, well, I think that if you don't give your own view of what happened, somebody else will, and you might want to have a vote. And he said, I'm signing up. And I won't tell you which one it was. But and we're also making some changes. We never did video captures with these before. So now we're getting to the end of the oral histories, and we're saying, hey, these three stories are really good stories. We would like to get you to tell that one story or that two stories on tape. And that's going well. So that's little upgrades. And finally, we know we need to upgrade our oral history storefront on our website. It's just needed a little work. And we're going to make it easier to access the oral histories and also get to the accompanying voice recordings, which are very cool. And you haven't seen the look on somebody's face when you can hand, like, you know, Jack McCain, you know, 30 hours of his grandfather talking on tape, and he's never heard his voice, you know, really, and telling his, literally, his story. And the fact that we have that is really powerful. And I'll just use one clip as an example. There's a clip from Vice Admiral Red Rayburn. And Red Rayburn, in his history, he talks about a conversation that he had with Arleigh Burke in 1956. And basically, Arleigh Burke called him in and says, we need fleet ballistic missile submarines, and we need them as fast as you could produce them. And he basically gave Red Rayburn a a letter of mark, a letter from the emperor, and said, go forth and give me these things. And his target that he gave him was an IOC, an interim operational capability by 1963, and I want the submarine by 1965. Red Rayburn took submarines apart that were on the building ways, inserted missile tubes. They commissioned the USS George Washington in December 1959, fired the first missile successfully in July 1960, and she went on patrol in November of 1960. And you know, I'm dying to ask Admiral Rogers, does he have a letter of mark on cyber? Because to do big things takes that kind of an effort. And really, that's the value of these. And you'd like to take the Ohio class replacement requirements officer and say, listen to Red Rayburn for a few minutes. So on naval history, I can't talk about preserving history. I've talked about the oral histories. Our oral history magazine, Naval History, is the best of its genre. And if you're not a subscriber, I need about 3,000 more subscribers to really be at the right level to support that magazine. So think about naval history. It truly is the best of its ilk. We want to encourage and publish new authors. And we've established Paul Merzlach, who was Proceedings Editor, as the editorial director in the press. And that's going to free Rick Russell to be more outwardly facing and more customer facing. We need to pay advances again. We need to improve the incentives and the awards for our Naval Institute Press authors. We also need to attract more big names who are currently working in the field, but they're publishing in New York. We want to be the publisher of choice in our field. Okay. So here's a good pick. We want to bring more energy and creativity to our partnerships. And of course, our number one partners are the sea services themselves. And that top shot is from our town hall discussion at West, which was super. And below is a shot from the Maritime Security Dialogue series done with CSIS right here in this room last August. And I'll tell you the story because I think that an exchange that happened there kind of epitomizes what we're about as the Naval Institute. So we had Admiral Prier, retired Admiral Prier, you know, former PACOM commander and U.S. ambassador to Beijing. And he was there with the Air Boss, Vice Admiral Xu Shoemaker, and Lieutenant General Doug Davis, who's on the right there, the Marine, who's the Deputy Commandant for Aviation. And they did their presentation on the future Naval Aviation. About the third or fourth question, Lieutenant stands up, and it's Lieutenant Miso right there. And he says, hey there, Air Boss, Lieutenant Miso. I think he gave his serial number now. But it was, he asked him about opportunity to be a carrier air wing commander and said, geez, you know, it's supposed to be for everybody, but we couldn't help but notice that for five straight years, nobody but a fighter pilot has become a CAG. And so Shoemaker goes, it's the funniest thing. I was just on the way over here. And Bill Moran, the Chief of Naval Personnel, fed me this article on CAGs and says, hey, Shu, you should read this. And I did. And he starts talking about it. He goes, wait a minute, LT, did you write that article? And Lieutenant, and Roger Miso goes, yeah, yes, I'm the one. But but good on them both, because the Air Boss invited Roger out. You know, it's okay to do the Naval Institute thing, but then he had to invite him out to Tailhook and have a aviator discussion, a 13XX discussion on that topic. And then later, after they agreed that he was absolutely right on every word of his article, he could back it up, they changed the precept for that administrative board to emphasize moving that around. But it took the lieutenant and his co-author to raise this up, and it's just the reaction you'd hope to get from the chain of command. We also seek a mentality of engagement, not a transactional or subscriber mentality. And our Warrior Writer exhibit, and I don't know if all of you caught that over at the Naval Academy, but we owe Claude Barrabee thanks for featuring the Naval Institute in that Warrior Writer exhibit. But that's the spirit that we need to keep alive. And there's, you could see Sandy Winnefeld with his wife Mary next to his, the younger Sandy Winnefeld, the author from the, you know, his days in the joint staff. But the whole point is that we want to define ourselves in terms of mission and beliefs instead of book discounts. It's not about book discounts. It's more. And to be the intellectual heart of the profession, we need to preserve the independent, nonpartisan, open forum. We need to preserve and share naval history and support the literary, scientific, and professional understanding of sea power. Next. I'm getting to the end here. This slide talks about academic institutions, and I just love these picks. It's a really short story. We're doing a history conference now with the Coast Guard Academy. It's accelerating. We're doing more this year. Our chair was the initial speaker, but we had 900 Coasties, cadets, seated there, 1,300, and it was a rock star deal. They loved it, and we need to be doing more of it. Next. We've made progress on serving our enlisted audience better. Again, having the same Fleet Master Chief Kingsbury, who's going to update the CPO guide, compete in the general prize essay contest, which is blind graded. So he's up against all the PhDs and the guys with their master's degrees. And this guy crushed it. He placed, and we're very proud of that. And that's what we should be doing. It's high time to engage this resource more fully in our forum. And we're working with the senior enlisted schools from all the sea services. And it's very good that we've got the enlisted essay contest back on track. Again, Textron has helped us with that, for which we're hugely grateful. And it was just today we picked the winner from 120 superb entrants. Next. The big message here is that we need to go after parents, and we think that we could be helping. The parents who send their children, they're sending their treasure to the services. And some of them are steeped in military history and tradition, but many of them are not. And we know that we could do better to assist those families. And we show some examples here, but we're going to take the Citizen's Guide to the U.S. Navy and convert it into the Parent's Guide to the U.S. Navy. And we're confident that we're going to fill an important gap. Next. International, we talked about the importance of this thrust, but we're pushing the International Navy's contest sponsored by DRS Finn Mechanica harder. We're making the international issue, the March issue on international navies, more consequential. We recently received a gift to sponsor the international students up at the Navy Command College in Newport. We just had a wonderful reception for them last week. And then USNI News is an important tool here, because if you look at the last 30 days of USNI News, 150,000 hits came from 225 other countries around the world. And finally, we had Admiral Takei, Chief of the Maritime Staff, head of the Japanese Navy at West, and we're going to do that more. Next. All right, this is our message. Foundation gifts are the investment capital of the Institute. And if you look, the oral histories, the sponsored student members, some of USNI News, our conference activity, our image archive, some book subventions like the Big E, and our sponsored student members are all able to be supported with the kind of capital that we get in the foundation. One of our latest initiatives that I want to kick the podium on is the Proceedings Trust. We've seen print magazine advertisements decline. And we've also seen in the media industry that there are six media conglomerates that now control over 90% of the media in the United States. And we want to preserve our independence, so we've asked people, help us set up proceedings so that we're not dependent on corporate ads. We still want the corporate ads, but we don't want to be solely dependent. And also, I'm happy to report that we've brought back and received a huge gift. Not, it brought back is the wrong term. We had no sponsorship for our general prize essay contest. So our most prestigious essay contest, dating back to 1879, first winner, Alfred Thayer Mahan. So it's a pretty good story. We had no sponsorship for that, but we've just received an extremely generous gift from the Taylor family in St. Louis to fund that essay contest in perpetuity. So it's very exciting. This is my last slide, but it may be the most important because we've made tremendous progress embracing our digital future, but we have more to do because the world around us is accelerating faster than we're changing in many cases, and we're riveted on modernizing our software for publishing, business intelligence, and finance, and we're working those selections now, and in 2017, we're going to execute. So that's it. I want to open for just a couple minutes if you have a question. I'm open for business on that. We have mics here and here, and we have time to take just a couple of questions before we get into our reward presentations. I think they're stunned. Okay. Well, so then I will take that as a good sign. And I will invite Mr. Fred Rainbow to come up and begin our recognition program. Thank you very much.
Thank you. As you've heard through Pete's remarks, the Naval Institute currently sponsors 11 essay contests. We have major awards program at West, where many essay winners are recognized and the sponsors are recognized. Two of our serving professionals were unable to join us at West, so we're going to insert them here. So in the Leadership Essay Contest, sponsored by Dr. J. Philip London and CACI, Captain Raphael Warfield won third prize for his essay entry, hashtag leadership. That article is in the May issue of the Proceedings. If I can ask Raphael to come up and Tony Lengridge, representing CACI, and we have the congratulations. I should point out that Captain Warfield is a repeat winner. He won last year in the Leadership Essay Contest. In the Information Warfare Essay Contest, now renamed the Cyber Essay Contest, sponsored with Hewlett-Packard Enterprises, Lieutenant Benjamin Morris won third prize for his essay, Data and Design. Lieutenant Morris argues that the military systems must look at the functionality, intuitiveness, and flexibility of the private sector technology. So if I can have Lieutenant Morris join us. So we're gonna do a tag team match, so the next person's up to present awards, I think is, Rick Russell.
I'm Rick Russell, Director of the Naval Institute Press, and it's my pleasure to introduce the Press Author of the Year for 2016. This year's winner is Vincent P. O'Hara. This award recognizes Vince's masterful ability to weave the disparate political, strategic, technological, and tactical elements of naval history into gripping narratives, exemplified by Torch, North Africa, and the Allied Path to Victory, published last September, that significantly advance our readers' understanding of naval power and the role played by international navies during the 20th century. Vince is the author or editor of 10 books and dozens of articles that have been published in the US, UK, and other countries, which have established him as one of the preeminent authors of operational naval history. His steadfast support of the Naval Institute and close cooperation with the press for more than a decade not only helped us to achieve our mission, but also have made the real work of book publishing more enjoyable. Vince, congratulations.
Get the medal.
Thank you. Thanks, Vince.
I'd like to thank Rick for the nice introduction. I have a couple remarks here, if you indulge me. It's a great honor to be standing here, but it's also a responsibility. The Naval Institute's mission is to provide a forum for those who write about sea power. Even though I'm not a naval professional, I'm not a veteran, and I'm not an academic, I'm standing here as an example of the Institute's mission in action, supporting the intellectual freedom that's been the U.S. Navy's best secret weapon. Historians realize that the world is a perilous place. The sea touches all cultures, it separates, and it unites nations. Sea power is security. My work is about the exercise and consequences of sea power in wartime. My history is German fleet at war, U.S. Navy against the Axis, and struggle for the Middle Sea are not just about naval battles. They provide a cumulative picture of how navies adapt to stress, how they develop doctrine. They give a picture of what worked in practice and what did not, the elements of victory and the aspects of defeat. My most recent book, Torch, North Africa and the Allied Path to Victory, has a lot to say in this regard. For example, the process of fighting as part of a coalition did not come naturally to the US military, but we did it, and we did it successfully. We established a pattern of not just how to conduct amphibious assaults, but also how to conduct joint and amphibious warfare. We took risks that today seem mind-boggling. I write about pattern, process, practice, patience, and persistence. Understanding and perspective puts us in a better position to practice sea power as a service, and most importantly, to appreciate it as a nation. I thank Naval Institute Press, particularly Tom Cutler, for supporting my work. I thank the members for buying and reading my books. I thank my parents, Vincent and Margaret, and my family, my daughter, Yun Wen, my son, Vincent, and my wife, Maria, for their patience, kindness, and for their support. Thank you. I'm humbled. I'm honored. And this is really a dream come true. So thank you.
Good afternoon. I'm Richard Latour, Editor-in-Chief of Naval History Magazine. Vice Admiral Robert F. Dunn, the 2015 Naval History Author of the Year, is one of the Navy's most accomplished aviators, as well as a longtime Naval Institute supporter and friend. A native of Chicago, Admiral Dunn graduated from the Naval Academy in 1951. After serving in the Korean War on board a destroyer escort, he received his wings in 1953. During two Vietnam War tours on Yankee Station off the coast of North Vietnam, he served as executive officer and then commanding officer of Attack Squadron 146. He later commanded Attack Carrier Air Wing 7, the aircraft carrier Saratoga, and Carrier Group 8. After duty as Chief of Naval Reserve and then Commander of Naval Air Force Atlantic Fleet, the Admiral concluded his active Navy service as Deputy Chief of Naval Operations for Air Warfare. Admiral Dunn joined the Naval Institute in 1951, and over the years, he's written a dozen or so articles and many more letters to the editors that have appeared in Proceedings in Naval History. Moreover, he's helped guide our organization. In the late 1980s, he served as a director on the Naval Institute Board of Control and as chairman of its editorial board. When he retired from the Navy, Admiral Dunn even spent several months working for the Institute as a consultant and senior advisor, And of course, he's long been a strong defender of the Institute's independent open forum. Today, Admiral Dunn is being honored for his December 2015 Naval History article, Navy Airstrike North Vietnam, as well as for his contributions to that issue's special gatefold graphics package, 122 Days on Yankee Station. This is personal as well as naval history, for the Admiral drew heavily on his own experiences as an A-4 Skyhawk pilot and as the XO and CO of VA-146. His article is an illuminating overview of Operation Rolling Thunder, the long U.S. air campaign against North Vietnam. In the piece, Admiral Dunn vividly recounts a typical Alpha strike, which could include 30 or more aircraft. He figuratively puts you in a Skyhawk cockpit, dodging surface-to-air missiles and rolling down through heavy anti-aircraft fire to deliver your bombs on target. Meanwhile, the gatefold is an account of the 1967 deployment of VA-146's air wing on board the USS Constellation off the coast of North Vietnam. During that Yankee Station tour, Commander Dunn earned 2 Silver Stars for planning and leading Alpha strikes against heavily defended targets near Haiphong. As one award citation stated, his exceptional courage, keen judgment, and peerless leadership were in keeping with the highest traditions of the United States Naval Service. It's my pleasure to introduce the 2015 Naval History Author of the Year, Vice Admiral Robert F. Dunn.
I think the only thing to say at this time, aside from thank you, is that you look at me and you heard my history, and if you live long enough, you'll get all kinds of prizes. But the award really should go to Richard and his staff, because all I did was tell a couple of sea stories, and they put them together and polished them and made a good article. Thank you very much.
Good afternoon, everyone. I'm Paul Merzlach, Editorial Director for the Naval Institute Press. During my many years as Editor-in-Chief of Proceedings, one of the best parts of the job, I thought, was being able to recognize our many talented authors, but particularly those who accepted our challenge to read, think, speak, and write, especially to read, think, speak, and write about things that may not be popular or may incur their superior's wrath or displeasure. Our 2015 Author of the Year, Coast Guard Lieutenant Commander Brian Smiklis, did that not once, but twice last year, and lived to tell the tale, and added good news, I just found out before the presentation, did make commander. So good on him and good on the Coast Guard. In August 2015, Commander Smiklis wrote Demise of the Cutterman. In it, he wrote that career cuttermen, and I quote, career cuttermen are becoming the dullest knife in the shoreside detailer's drawer. He knows what he's talking about here. He's a career cutterman with more than 10 years sea time, including command of the cutter Key Biscayne. He discussed the cutterman's current career path and described it as an increasingly rocky one, as the lure of shoreside service, with its multiple avenues of advancement and less Spartan and demanding lifestyle than is found on lengthy cutter deployments, is starting to attract more and more junior officers and making cutter service look less and less optimal. If this trend continues, he wrote, a crisis in command could loom, as fewer top-tier leaders in the future will have served at sea. Without a course change, the Service's Officer Corps will become fundamentally detached from the underpinnings of more than 2 centuries of service tradition, and could degrade the Coast Guard's ability to remain semper paratus. He called on the Coast Guard to immediately integrate career cuttermen within shoreside sector leadership positions, strengthen cutter law enforcement programs, and more appropriately recognize the challenges of serving at sea. But not enough for him, he struck again 2 months later in October 2015. The normalization of relations with Cuba was welcome news to many when it occurred almost 18 months ago. It holds a lot of promise for the future of Cuban-American relations. But there is a cloud on the horizon, one which most people may not think of. Cuba, for many years, has been a very dependable ally in the war on drugs. For decades, the island has acted as a barrier to the illegal drug trade. Now, that barrier could fall. In his October article, Cuba, the Coast Guard, and Chaos, was that your title or did we come up with that? Lieutenant Commander Smiklis wrote that we can expect the smuggling of both drugs and human cargo will greatly increase, and the Coast Guard will have its hands full, especially in the Florida Straits. Clearly, some sort of concerted effort will be required. Luckily, there's already a template in place. Again, most Americans, probably not aware, I know I certainly wasn't when I read this, we already have a partnership in place with Cuban authorities. Lieutenant Commander Smiklis was able to write authoritatively about this because he was, at one time, our man in Havana, or in other words, the Coast Guard's drug interdiction specialist assigned there to work with officials in combating the narcotics trade. He writes about the great partnership already between the two countries, a relationship that will now become even more vital. Cuba should be considered one of the United States' best partners in the fight against drug smuggling, he wrote, and called for the Coast Guard to immediately act to strengthen the existing partnerships with the island nation. For these two superb contributions to the open forum, it is our great pleasure to recognize Lieutenant Commander Brian Smiklis as the 2015 Proceedings Author of the Year.
Echo Mr. O'Hara's comments. It's an honor, and it comes with great responsibility as well. And the first thing I'd like to take responsibility for, I want to thank the Naval Institute for dedicating some pages to the Coast Guard. I understand we are a fraction of the readership, a fraction of the membership, but to have two articles published in the same year is an honor to not just me, but to the Coast Guard, and I'm thankful for the visibility that this has provided. I'd also like to thank my supervisors who are here and supporting me. Thank you very much, and continue to support me. And most importantly, thank my wife. We mentioned 10 years at sea, which is a little bit rare for an 04, 05 select now, thanks. But 10 years at sea is a lot of birthdays, a lot of kids' birthdays, a lot of anniversaries. I don't have to tell it to this crowd. So any effort I can do when writing Demise of the Cutterman to help improve the plight of those choosing to go to sea or being compelled to go to sea, to help improve their situation, to make it more equitable, more fair, and more, frankly, more opportunities, then that's my honor as well. So thank you again for the honor.
Of all the essay contests we talked to you about, the Naval Institute's General Prize Essay Contest is the longest, 137 years. This competition this year included 120 entries. These essays were judged in the blind by the editorial board. The editorial board selected the three winners we're going to honor today. Third prize goes to Fleet Master Chief Paul Kingsbury for his essay, What Makes the CPO Mess Tick? Master Chief Kingsbury lays out a clear track to make the CPO mess all it can be. Master Chief. In addition to this medal, he gets a $2,000 prize. Second prize goes to Brendan Stickles for his essay, Twilight for Manned Flight. In his essay, Commander Stickles makes the case that every aviator should fully embrace the future of assisted, unmanned, autonomous aviation platforms. For his essay, Commander Stickles receives $3,000 and a medal. Commander? That dare factor worked a little bit against him because he didn't wear his uniform today, so they couldn't find him. The first prize goes to Lieutenant Commander Jared Wilhelm for his essay, Admiral Nelson's Twitter Feed. Commander Wilhelm demonstrates why he believes Admiral Horatio Lord Nelson would have embraced social media, kind of like our chairman does, and why today's Navy leaders need to do so now. Come on up. For his essay, he received $6,000 in this medal. Now, the essay contests have been generating a lot of wonderful copy for us, giving us a great opportunity. Starting in January, we're going to expand our coverage of proceedings online or whatever we come up with as a name. So we're looking forward to working with everybody in this room more, and thank you for the contributions you make.
Well, I think, as everybody knows, our next guest, our speaker, will be Admiral Mike Rogers, who will be arriving momentarily. So we have two choices. In the Greek Orthodox Church, at this point, we would stand and pass the peace, or you can stand and take a stretch break. Please do not depart your seats, and the Admiral will be here shortly. Enjoy. Please take your seats. Thank you very much. Thank you very much. Please take your seats. Wonderful. Well, I think we survived that rather nicely. I want to introduce Admiral Mike Rogers, who is not only an extraordinary officer who today leads U.S. Cyber Command and is dual-hatted over at the National Security Agency, but he is also my very good friend. I've known Admiral Rogers for probably close to 20 years. He is a proud graduate of Auburn University. War Eagle, thank you. He is a surface warfare officer qualified on board USS Karen, Spruance-class destroyer. He went to sea in 1981, did a fantastic job on that ship, and decided that the future for him would involve cryptology, one of the, I will say, the most naval of the arms of military professionalism dealing with our ability to understand what is moving on enemy circuits. Mike has a mind that is well designed to do cryptology. He is brilliant, not a word that I use loosely or often. Throughout his career as a cryptologist, Mike has served in every billet and every level you would expect. He's been the cryptological officer at fleets and at strike groups. He has then proven his complete diversity and effectively has done, at this point, I would say, as much intelligence as he has cryptology. He went on to be the J2 at U.S. Pacific Command, the J2 on the Joint Staff, and then effectively merged those two to become the commander of the 10th Fleet. He was then selected from that for his fourth star, becoming an extraordinary surface warfare officer success story. He is also someone everybody likes. Mike is a great colleague, a great shipmate, a terrific father, a family man. Throughout all my dealings with him over a couple of decades, I have always found him to be the gold standard of judgment and advice and kindness and civility, a terrific leader, a shipmate, and one of the great minds in our naval service today, Admiral Mike Rogers. Michael.
Well, to be honest, I'm very embarrassed after that introduction. But I thank Jim Stradgridis both for the introduction, but more appropriately for the mentorship, leadership, and the scholarship that he has demonstrated as a maritime professional over a lifetime of service. Even when I was a junior officer, everybody knew about Jim Stradgridis. Why? Because he published. And today, previously, we have recognized the excellence of those in writing in multiple forms and formats about pursuing excellent knowledge and understanding in the maritime professions, whether you're a Marine, Coast Guardsman, or a Naval officer. I am a firm fan of the Naval Institute. I believe in its mission. It's one of the reasons why when Admiral Daly said, hey, Mike, would you be willing to come speak? I said, I would do it in a heartbeat. Because as a Naval officer and a member of the Naval Institute for over 34 years, I have been the lucky beneficiary of much of the insight that this institution has helped to develop. And you see that play out. You think about the titles that we just recognized. Hashtag leadership. At Admiral Nelson. Data and design. You see cyber information and insight, an important part of the dialogue today in the maritime professions, and as we're thinking about the future. Although it's a good example of where we still have some space to go, that when we published at hashtag leadership, we had to put in parenthesis, hey, this symbol really means hashtag. I thought to myself, we're still in that transition phase. We're still in that transition phase. So what I thought I'd do is share with you a few thoughts on kind of where we are today, where I think we're going, and then I'll take any question on any topic, because the greatest value is in the interaction between us, because I do these things in part because I'm interested in hearing what's on other people's mind, what's your perspective as you look at this cyber set of challenges. So if I had to assess where we are today, we are in the early stages of a journey that is going to be continuing for a long time. But I believe cyber is foundational to our role as a service and as a military. And as you heard from Admiral Stavridis, I started my career as a surface warfare officer. And if I had to pick the what has formulated my career, I would argue that first two or three years on that 963, in many ways, that has shaped me more than anything else I've ever done. It gave me a thought process, it gave me a viewpoint, and it gave me a way to think about the world around me that I still use today now as a four-star as opposed to when I was a JG or a lieutenant on that ship. One of the things I always remember about my time as a surface officer, it did not matter what you did, but as an officer on that platform, whether you're combat systems, ops, or engineering, there were two fundamentals that you had to know. The first was how to navigate safely in the maritime environment in accordance with the rules of the road. Everybody had to know it, like the back of your hand. No ifs, ands, or buts. Didn't matter if you were the CIC officer, if you were the main propulsion assistant, if you were the fire control officer, everybody had to know it. The second thing was, you had to know the plant. Because if you don't understand your plant, you got no propulsion. You got no propulsion, you got no mobility. You got no mobility, your probability of defensive successful outcomes really start to diminish. And you got no propulsion, you got no power. You got no power, you got no sensors. You got no weapon systems. That's a really bad place to be. And so it was always pounded into you. No matter what you do, you got to understand the fundamentals. And as I look at cyber, the analogy I try to use with people is, look, cyber is much like that surface analogy in my mind. For all of us, as we think about the future, there will be a requirement for all of us to have a foundational level of both the capabilities
the limitations and the potential opportunities that cyber offers. It doesn't mean that every member of the military, for example, is going to be an in-depth cyber warrior. I was never a chief engineer. I never knew the plant to that level, but I knew the fundamentals, and I knew what to do if we established damage, or if I was the officer of the deck, or I had the con or the deck. I think it's likewise the same thing when I think about cyber. It's a foundational knowledge and skill set that we're all going to have some level of insight and capability about. It's going to be a part of our toolkit. As I think about where we are in a journey, and I'll focus at the department level, vice at the service level, though as you heard in my last job before this current set of responsibilities, I was the senior operational commander in the Navy for cyber and signals intelligence at 10th Fleet and Fleet Cyber Command. As I look across the department, I say, look, the positive side is we have recognized the problem. When I go back 5, 10 years, we were spending a lot of time discussing the problem and trying to decide, is this something we really ought to invest in? We're way past that discussion. So the first step in solving any challenge is always recognition. So the positive side is we've got fundamental recognition and endorsement and buy-in from the senior-most leadership of our department as well as that of our nation. I think we've got a pretty good roadmap, particularly on the defensive side, about the way ahead. We know what we have to do. But as I always remind the leadership, we have to overcome decades of a very different approach to how we invested. It's only been recently that when it comes to our networks and our combat systems, that we thought about redundancy, resiliency, and defensibility from a cyber perspective. We did not build those in as core design characteristics. If we're honest with ourselves about our networks, it was maximum effectiveness at cheapest price, because we didn't think they were going to be contested. It was all about, hey, this is a service, it's a capability. Maximize its capability, but do it at a reasonable price point. Now we find ourselves in a very different environment where those same capabilities that we built now represent potential vulnerability. So we've got to make significant changes in our infrastructure, and we've got to think beyond networks. We've got to think about weapon systems and platforms, because the same things that we've built into our weapon systems and our platforms to enable remote access for a variety of very valid reasons now represent potential points of vulnerability for us. And just as we're able to use that remote access to generate insight and knowledge that helps us do some very good things, that also potentially represents points of vulnerability for an opponent to exploit. So we've got to work our way through that. And we really have started on the network piece. It's the combat systems and the system side where I think we've got the greatest level of growth still to go. On the offensive side, still in the early days, we have publicly acknowledged for the first time as a department that we are using cyber as an element of our broader effort against ISIL in Syria and Iraq. I apologize, I'm just not going to go into details, but we have publicly done that. That is in part both to ensure that the opponent understands we are committed to fighting you every bit as much in the non-kinetic world as we are in the kinetic world, and that we realize that the informational aspect of this opponent's capabilities are an important part of their strategy, and that we have to be able to negate that part of their strategy. And so we'll work our way through that challenge set. A lot of times I get asked, so, you know, Mike, what's the next big thing in cyber? And what I say is, we've got to get cyber out of the industrial age, heavily manpower dependent, to a much more thinking and autonomous structure where we can truly focus manpower at the point where it generates the greatest advantage. And the greatest advantage to me is not focusing that manpower on the very repetitive industrial kinds of activities. It's focusing that manpower in positions where it can use the power of its intellect and its experience to generate maximum outcomes, where variable and uncertainty is high, and you need experience, training, education to make really tough decisions with incomplete knowledge. And because of the speed of cyber, you sometimes have to make those decisions at very fast speeds. One of the things I tell our team, I said this when I was a fleet commander, now I say this as the joint guy, you must condition yourself as a leader to act with incomplete information in this domain. If you are going to wait for perfect knowledge, you are way behind the power curve, and the opponent will have seized the initiative. We must be capable of acting with incomplete knowledge. As a leader, that is an interesting challenge watching organizations getting out of that comfort zone. Hey, I think I just need to wait. And it's always a balance. You know, that's and one reason why the maritime profession is both a science and an art. And we acknowledge that it is the human dimension that remains ever critical. If you look at some of the recognition we did previously today when we recognized authors, I also was heartened by the fact we talked about leadership and we talked about historical context, whether it was in the campaign of Vietnam with Admiral Dunn, whether it was talking about the current situation and the Coast Guard issue on the side of Cuba. And I apologize, I'm blanking out. There was one more I thought was really interesting that was a good. Oh, it was, what is the future of unmanned flight, manned versus unmanned aviation? I thought to myself, that is a perfect microcosm of the way ahead for us. We got to understand how we can harness the insights of the past with the technology of today and tomorrow. Because remember, I am always talking to my team. Man has dealt with fundamental changes in technology for a long time. So have militaries. For us right now, it's cyber and the power of the digital age. Centuries ago, it was gunpowder. It was nuclear propulsion. It was the transition from wood to steel. It was the ability to generate integrated logistics trains at speed that enable the carrier strike group to span a hemisphere and project power all the way on the other side of the Pacific. We've had fundamental changes before in technology and operational concepts. So don't be intimidated by, this cyber thing is, it's tough technology. It's hard for me to understand. At its heart, cyber is an operational environment in which we often do a variety of very traditional things. We maneuver, we do reconnaissance, we execute fires. I'm like, hey, I remember doing that as a surface officer. You know, we can do this, but it requires us to get out of our comfort zone. And the last point really I would leave you with, because the greatest value is in our interaction with each other. The greatest challenge in cyber, in my mind, it is not technology. The greatest challenge is culture to me. Technology is an important component of our future and our strategy with respect to cyber. And I acknowledge that without its application in an effective way, we will not be able to achieve the end state that we're striving for. But on the other hand, I also recognize, even with the greatest technology in the world, if you don't have the right operational mindset, if you haven't created the right culture, if you haven't remembered the power of people, we're not going to get where we need to go either. And at its heart, cyber, like so many other missions in the United States Department of Defense, is about harnessing the intellect and the drive and heart of motivated men and women who want to make a difference. And in my world, they want to make that difference with a keyboard. But they want to do the same thing that the sailors that I was fortunate enough to lead 30 years ago, OSs and sonar techs as a CIC officer and an anti-submarine warfare officer on board that first ship, I think to myself, hey, a lot of things haven't changed. It's still about how do you motivate young men and women? How do you focus them as a team? How do you set that vision as a leader? And how do you move out to generate outputs? Because in the end, we're not investing in cyber because, it's really neat, or it's really new, or it's really sexy. We're investing in cyber because we believe it will generate better operational outcomes for us, and that by harnessing its powers and its capabilities, will also preclude the options of others who might want to use it as a tool against us. That's why we do this. And so I always remind our team, ladies and gentlemen, don't ever forget, it's about operational outcomes. It's about operational outcomes. It's about operational outcomes. That's what we're about. And with that, what's all on your minds? Sir.
Hi, Kevin Winsing.
Kevin, this is cheating. I can't help myself.
Well, you mentioned people, so I was going to ask, how do you recruit? You know, cyber is a kind of a unique area. How do you recruit people, bring them in, maybe on and off ramps, and getting people from the technology world to go into the military, for example?
So the nice thing is, I started doing cyber as an 06, about 14 years ago. So pretty late in a career. And I can remember when I was as an 06, shows you how far we've come. As 14 years ago, I was an 06 on the joint staff, and cyber at that time on the joint staff, we had one organization that did ops plans and did the J6 function, run by an 06, and we embedded it in the J3 for the entire joint. Boy, have we come a long way since then. And I just happened to be that 06. I had two concerns. I'm going to riff off your question just a little bit. Number one concern to me was, is cyber so foundationally different that the lexicon, the tactics, techniques, and procedures, and the warfighting constructs that we have developed for the more traditional domains, will they not apply in cyber? And I can remember thinking at the time, ooh, boy, we're going to have to come up with a totally different lexicon. We need a different operational construct. And 14 years later, I think to myself, you know, Rogers, you really got that wrong. To me, you start from a premise that says, as I said before, cyber is an operational domain in which we conduct a variety of often very traditional evolutions. And therefore, maximize to the best extent you can the terminology, the tactics, techniques, and procedures that we're using in every other domain. Don't make this something so unique, so special, that it's neither integrated into the broader scheme of maneuver, or it intimidates people. And they go, boy, this is so specialized, I can't learn this. You know, Rogers, you go do this. That's not gonna work for us. The second, and this really, Kevin, goes to your question, the second concern I had was, does this manpower structure that we have in the department, is this gonna work? Because remember the basic premise of that structure. We're a pyramid, big base, narrow top. You either promote or we send you home. You generally focus on learning your operational or technical skill early when you're at the base of the pyramid. And the more we bring you up the pyramid, the more we want you to focus on leadership, and we want you to build on that core skill, but apply it in a broader context. And the other thing generally we do, we say is, look, we want you to have, particularly as an officer, we want you to have a broad set of experiences and a broad set of perspectives. And to do that, you can't keep doing the same thing over and over again. So we often say, so you want to broaden your portfolio of experience. So with that, I think to myself, so how do you build a workforce that's got in-depth technical knowledge in an area in which change is the constant, and in which, quite frankly, you want people to be able to generate deep knowledge over extended periods of time? And I was really concerned, boy, this isn't going to work. I wasn't quite as wrong as I was in the first one, but I'm still happily surprised by how it has turned out. Every service has now gone to designating, if you will, a dedicated full-time professional cyber workforce. So you can now actually, regardless of the service, officer enlisted, build a career path for yourself. Well, this is what you will do during your entire military service. So now we can get in-depth exposure, and we can get dedicated exposure, and we can give you jobs at every level, E1 through E9, O1 through O10, that keep building on that experience. That's a real positive for us, and that's something that we've only really done within the last 3 to 5 years. And I'll be the first to acknowledge, it was not always even. You had some services that jumped to this very early, and you had a couple others that said, hey, we need to really be convinced before we make what would be a fundamental change to our model. So we've been able to recruit good men and women, and we've been able to sustain that expertise over time. Retention for the cyber skill sets in the uniform world have exceeded expectations and the numbers that we've set for ourselves in terms of how do you sustain this. I think that's in part driven simplistically by a couple things. Number one, much as any rating in any ship, we have dedicated men and women who want to be part of something bigger themselves, and they want to help defend and serve the nation. And they just want to do it with a keyboard. But they're incredibly motivated. And secondly, the self-image of the workforce that I'm fortunate enough to be a part of is largely, we're the warriors of the 21st century. We're the future. That doesn't, it's not a negative comment about anybody else or the skill set, but their self-image is, hey, we're doing something that matters. We're the future. You can't underestimate the value as a leader of working for people who that's their self-image. I mean, they are pumped, they are motivated, they are pushing. As a leader, I love that. The bigger concern I have is less the uniform segment of our team and a little bit more on the civilian side. Because I think you made an important point. We have got to create a model where we can bring people in and out of this. And traditionally, the model for us is, hey, as a uniform, once you leave, you're gone. Largely, simplistically, that's it. Civilian-wise, same thing in many ways. And I'm going, I don't think that's optimal for the future. We've got to create a model where you can work with us for a while, leave, come back. You can never have worked within the department at all, but you got some really great skills that we can really take advantage, and we can bring you in. And we can't bring you in until you got to start at the base. I run into a lot of people out in Silicon Valley who will say to me, hey, Mike, I've had a lot of success out here. I've built myself a successful career. My children are now grown. You know, I've been able to create a good lifestyle for myself and my family, but I want to give back. And I'm thinking, man, we have got to make it easier to harness this kind of capability and this expertise. Because if I say to that individual, hey, how'd you like to get hired as a GS-7 or a GS-13? They just look at me like, what? Hey, I want to help, but I'm not so sure that that's the price that I'm willing to do to help. And that's not unreasonable. I don't think it's unreasonable to ask someone to come in, acknowledging I can't pay you at an executive vice president level in the tech sector, but I think we can bring you in for a while, take advantage of your skill sets, give you the opportunity to that sense of, hey, I'm paying back the nation. I think we can do that. So that's something that we've got to keep working on. Sir.
Admiral, thanks for coming. My name is Joe Ponzer. I'm with the Naval Institute.
Hey, Joe.
We hear a lot about cyber attack and defense. I'm wondering if there's anything you can say about if we're doing anything in the area of forecasting behavior and complex systems. So, for instance, there's like 10,000 hedge funds in the world. There's about 25 of them that are using hardcore quantitative methods, advanced mathematics, advanced geometry data, Bayesian stuff to predict behavior in complex systems. And I was wondering if there's anything that we're doing on that side that you could talk about.
So are we trying to do the same thing? Yes. About how do you harness the power of data and analytics to postulate a future? Boy, this is where the intel officer side of me goes. You know, I always felt good. Now in 2 years, when it was 2 to 5 years, it was always okay. Boy, when it got to 10 or 20 years, I can always remember thinking to myself, man, I have never succeeded. You know, I can remember as the theater, the senior intel guy in the Pacific, as the PACON J2, I would often tell the theater commander, sir, we have never gotten these guys right out west. I mean, we have always underestimated, we've always been behind, we've always been slow. And I'm always mindful of that, which is one reason why I think part of the answer is, how do we get external expertise to do this? I think as an organization, and I would argue this is true for any organization, not just Department of Defense, we gotta be honest with ourselves, we gotta step back and ask ourselves, what are the core skills that we have that we're really good at? And what are the skills that we need that we don't necessarily have a lot of and we're not good at? And how do we go out and acquire or at least access those skills? And this is an area traditionally where we haven't been as strong as I think this mission set demands of us. Because the price of getting, of projecting that future and getting it wrong is really high for us. And I just, it's somewhat different but related. I was just having a discussion in my NSA hat about what are the core technologies that we want to invest in the future. And I was talking to the team about, I'm leery about placing the chips down too early. Because if we self-limit early on in this process and we sink big money into this, boy, the price of getting this wrong is not only are we operationally behind in terms of our ability to generate insights that the policymakers and operational commanders are counting on, but we will have spent a whole lot of money. And in a declining resource environment, guys, we can't afford to do that. So, sir.
Hi, Admiral. It's hard to think about cyber without also thinking about China. After the meeting with President Obama and President Xi, I guess the question for you is, has the hemorrhaging slowed down or stopped?
Well, remember, we are in an unclassified open forum. so to remind us, we're all on the same sheet of music on the 25th of September at the conclusion of a summit between President Xi Jinping and President Obama. The two leaders came out and announced that they had reached an understanding with respect to some aspects of behavior in cyber, specifically that neither nation would use the power and capability of the nation state to use cyber as a tool to generate economic advantage for the private sector. Put another way, penetrate systems, steal intellectual property using the capabilities of the nation state, and then turning it over to the private sector to build. That has always been our position. Hey, as the director of the National Security Agency, I am the first to acknowledge that we have interest in generating insights as to what is being done around the world with the development of advanced weapons and capabilities that could conceivably be employed against the United States or our allies. We acknowledge that we do that. At the same time, we don't take that insight and then go to Boeing or Lockheed and say, here's what the fifth generation fighter in company in country X, Y, or Z is going to look like, and this is what you got to compete against in 5 to 10 years. We don't do that in our system. That's not true in other models, and the push that we had with our Chinese counterparts was this behavior is precluding our ability to have the kind of relationship that both of our nations want with each other. You need to understand how foundational this is to us. This is not something that's in the realm of the acceptable. And so I thought the positive side was they came to an agreement. Now, we're coming up on 7 months or so since then. The million-dollar issue always is, because we acknowledge nation states will engage in behavior designed to generate insight. The United States does that, every nation does that. Some have more capability, more capacity than others, but fundamentally every nation does that. And we're not saying that nations shouldn't attempt to use their capabilities to generate insight. Hey, on the positive side, that's probably a net gain. It leads to a more knowledgeable world, we hope a safer world, and we hope a world in which parties, nation states, groups, individuals perhaps understand each other better, and we can make better policy and operational decisions. That's a good thing for all of us. So we continue to see some behaviors. The jury, from my perspective, you know, my comment has been, we need to give this a little bit more time before we come to a definitive answer. It's something that we continue to pay great attention to, though. Sir.
Admiral Rick Easton, thank you for your thoughts and assessment on cyber. One thing that I am reassured about is that you, as the guy who really knows probably the most about it, seems confident that we're on a path that it can be approached similarly how we've approached things in the past and succeed. But my question, which evolves around your initial statement, that the very first things you learned on your destroyer was seamanship and navigation, and then you had to know about the engineering plant. So there were clearly two priorities. So where are we with cyber today? Cyber still is mysterious to me. That may be because I'm very visual. I can see the Russian jet do the barrel roll over the ship. But yet, is cyber foundational so that every officer, every person, sailor on that ship needs to understand it before you can safely navigate and then do the engineering? And how are we going to defeat, from that perspective, the enemies of, say, 2025 and beyond?
So I don't know that if it's, one before the other. The point I try to make is, if we have given you access to a keyboard, you now represent a potential point of opportunity as well as a potential point of vulnerability. And the choices you make as an individual operator on that keyboard and in that network and in that weapon system that you're directing have potential implications for a much broader segment of the force than just the small piece you are working at. And the reality is, we have given everyone access to a keyboard. If you step back, we have, as a percentage of our, just take the Navy as an example, as a percentage of our service, it's a pretty small percentage of people that are actually in a cockpit with a finger on a weapon system, that are physically manning a fire control console on a platform somewhere. And yet, we've literally given everyone access to a keyboard and a network. And we've connected that network across the globe to execute a breadth of functions, whether we're doing it in an unclassed arena or we're doing it in a more classified arena. When we talk about foundational principles, first of all, it is amazing what contact with an opponent teaches you. I would be the first to admit, for me, we have publicly acknowledged previously that, and this is when I was Fleet Cyber Command, that a nation state penetrated the unclassified CONUS segment of the Navy's network backbone. And my job as the commander was, hey, drive them out, regain control, and full functionality. Until you're actually in contact with an opponent in this arena, the intellectual part of you that knows what to do, it is, I just can't describe. To me, it was the same experience I had when we get all the training and we're ready to go on that first deployment for me. And little did I know that my first deployment as a surface warfare officer, I'm going to get told in the classic naval fashion on the ship, we're proceeding west with John F. Kennedy to do a med deployment. It's October 1983, and within the first 18 hours leaving Norfolk, because I was on a spruance out of Norfolk, we get the classic naval message, detach from formation and proceed at best possible speed to a Latin long. I remember going up with the quartermaster, looking on the chart, and this is Lieutenant J.G. Rogers again, and I'm going, where the hell is this? Well, it's in the Caribbean, but where? I don't know, the only thing we can see is this looks to be close to an island called Grenada. And I remember us all thinking, what is in Grenada? They do like spices, right? My memory was, they're big into spices down there, right? Because it's the only thing I could remember. And from there, you know, and so suddenly I find myself, I'm the gunfire liaison officer, and I'm doing naval gunfire missions for the 82nd Airborne as they're dropping on the Point Salinas airfield, and for the 22nd MEU as we're putting them ashore north of St. George's, the capital. And I'm thinking to myself, boy, I've just completed all the gunfire ranges in Vieques, again, showing my age in Vieques, done ref tray in Gitmo. I thought I was ready for this. And it wasn't that I wasn't professionally ready, but I can remember thinking to myself as a leader sitting down with my guys, talking about, guys, it's a whole different ballgame. I'm confident in your ability to have the skills, but you got to think now about the mental piece of all this. And it's a different mindset. It takes a different approach to doing business. It's not enough just to have the basic skills. And that's exactly what I found myself in this scenario. Then as a three-star, 30-some-odd years later, thinking about, okay, intellectually, I know what we got to do, but I'm maneuvering against an opponent in contact. And I'm watching this opponent react to what we're doing. And I'm thinking, how do we retain advantage? How do we keep the initiative? How do we keep driving them to the outcomes that help facilitate where we want to get to, not where they want to get to? Among my takeaways, to go to your question about, so what are basic tenets? I said, guys, remember, cyber has key terrain just like every other domain. What's the key terrain that an opponent wants to control to achieve their desired outcomes? And I can remember the look on their faces when they said, key terrain? I'm going, look, what does the maritime environment teach us? Choke points, how conditions and water depth tend to shape where we go, traffic that, guys, we're used to this idea. We get shaped and driven by the environment in which we operate in the maritime environment. In some ways, it's the same thing in the cyber environment. The opponent wants to achieve a specific outcome. To achieve that outcome, they need to hold key terrain or put at risk our centers of gravity. What are the centers of gravity and what's the key terrain? As soon as we started thinking like that, it was, as a leader, it was, man, it's one of the things that I'm happiest about my entire career. Just watching these men and women, bam, total different mindset, and now we're ahead. And now we're out maneuvering, we're out thinking this opponent. So to me, there are touchstones, just as there were in that surface environment, that I take away that I think, you know, apply fully in the cyber domain. It's not as if, well, it's all just rocket science and some computer tells me what to do. It doesn't work that way at all. Sir.
Yes, sir. Thank you for joining us today. Bill Nolte from the University of Maryland, also retired from NSA.
All right. Thank you for your service.
Yes, still a reservist.
Right.
I left a class of undergraduates about 4 hours ago, brilliant computer science students, 60 AP credits, who, when I pre-tested them at the start of the semester, I teach a course in cyber policy, were struggling to name three countries on the western border of Russia. That's the way it goes. Weren't quite sure which amendment to the Constitution governed search and seizure. Jack. Tuesday, I will go into graduate students in public policy. Mm-hmm. Who couldn't tell me what a megahertz is. And when I asked them which came first, the integrated circuit or the vacuum tube, they struggled. So how do you, when you said that...
Well, at least they didn't say tubes. What are those?
Some of them did, to be perfectly fair. But how do you deal with, you talked about cyber being more than technology, about being culture. How do you get that full spectrum understanding of this problem across to your military personnel, your civilian personnel, and the public at large?
Jack. Well, the first thing I say is, look, there's multiple tiers of knowledge and understanding here. It's not one size fits all. So when I was Fleet Cyber Command and I was focused from a service perspective, the argument I and others, it wasn't just Rogers. I said, look, I think there's three broad populations we gotta get to. We need to ensure the entire force, military and civilian, has a basic understanding of cyber and the potential implications of their actions as an individual. Secondly, we need to realize that we're gonna need a dedicated high-end set of individuals who have really specific skill sets, and we gotta train them to a much higher level of understanding. And then thirdly, we've gotta focus on operational commanders and help them understand cyber in a broader, more operational, more strategic way. He said, hey, that's the sweet spot for us. We've gotta realize, we've gotta break this population into elements, and we've gotta ask ourselves, what do each of the elements need to know? And then what's the best way to go about doing it? So the way we're trying to do it now is a combination of foundational training at whatever your initial session point is. I just was out at Annapolis and spoke to about 1,200 midshipmen earlier in the week, and I said, look, it is not by chance that in your time here at the Naval Academy, think about what we've done. We have brought back celestial navigation, and you must now understand the use of a sextant. And like many of you, the Navy I joined as a surface warfare officer, flashing light, manual Morse, signal flags, celestial navigation. You wanted to qualify as a surface warfare officer, you had to do all of it. I told them, it is also not by chance that now we have a requirement for every one of you as a midshipman, you must take two cyber courses to graduate. And thirdly, it is not by chance that we are building a cyber center out at the Naval Academy, and we have created a cyber major. And finally, for the first time as a service last year, we commissioned fully physically qualified officers directly into the cyber portion of our service. Not non-physically qualified officers, because one of my comments with my teammates on the Navy leadership side always was, we need to harness the power of these investments. And it makes no sense to me to make these kind of investments in Annapolis and yet not gain the immediate benefit of them. So I'm really happy with that. So to me, it's a continuum. There's no one-size-fits-all approach to doing business here. The other point I would make, and I apologize, I'm riffing a little bit off your question, and this is one area where I probably have a slightly different perspective than some of my predecessors. I don't think that generating a cookie-cutter, one-size-fits-all workforce is the right way to go about doing this. I believe that we will generate better outcomes with a spectrum of experience and capabilities within the cyber workforce, to include both those with formal cyber education and background, as well as those with different perspectives, different experiences. So if you just take US Cyber Command as a microcosm, hey, they grew me from a test tube for these two jobs. I was a surface guy, then I was a cryptologist, and then I got into cyber over the course of the last 14 years. My deputy is an Air Force Space guy who did an Air Force Space three-star, who really didn't get into cyber until about 5 years ago. The J3 in our organization, I specifically went to the department and said, I got a lot of people who are really knowledgeable about cyber out here. You know what I really want in a J3? I want somebody who understands maneuver, I want somebody who understands risk, and I want somebody who understands prioritization of finite resources. I said, can you get me a carrier strike group skipper? And I went to the CNO and said, look, I'd like to bring a post carrier strike group commander out here to be the J3. Because I think that individual brings a lot of value. As I constantly kid Mike Gilday, who is our J3, Mike, you're used to doing this all the time when you're a strike group commander. How do you allocate finite resources? How do you take platforms with multiple capabilities and employ them to the maximum extent, realizing there's always trade-offs? Hey, you understand maneuver, you understand risk. That's what we need here. Our J5, Air Force F-16 pilot, who didn't start in cyber until about 7 years ago, but F-16 squadron commander, wing, numbered in a wing, a group in a wing. It's an F-16 guy. I said, man, you bring a lot to this fight. So I think part of the challenge in building a workforce of the future is be leery of making it all Mike Rogers. Get a broader set of experiences. The other reason why I'm a big fan of doing that is, hey, look, when that J3 leaves and he's going to go do something else in the joint world or in the United States Navy, hey, look, he's going to bring a lot of experience in cyber that he's now gained in 2 years as the J3 and the primary operational force focused on cyber for us as a department. He is going to be able to use that knowledge in whatever job we send him to. And if we've made a good investment and he becomes, numbered fleet commander, potentially a COCOM or a naval component commander at some point in the future, who knows if that's the way it'll work. Look at the investment we will have made and look at how this will pay off for us as a department. Because you want a broad spectrum of experiences, and over time, you want to have created an environment where you got a pretty wide set of experiences. So when we're sitting in the tank, you just don't want it to be, okay, Rogers, you're the only guy who understands this, what do you think? That's not. Put another way, when it comes to, for example, one thing I've told the leadership of the department, we will have failed if when it is time for me to go home, you can only come up with one or two people who you think are qualified. I'm like, guys, we've gotten this totally wrong then. We've got to build a bench where the leadership feels comfortable that there are multiple high-quality individuals who are posed, qualified, and ready to take on this level of responsibility. We can't view this as, well, it's a one-off with there's maybe one or two people. And that's one of my goals. Whenever it's time for me to go home, one of my goals is, and I spend a lot of time as a senior, how do we build a bench of the future? How do we identify talent? Where do we invest it? What's the experience that it needs? What's the skill set it needs? And what do we got to do to build that over time? I spend a lot of time on that. Sir?
This will be the last question.
Okay, you're the last. He's vicious. He's relentless.
Well, this is going to be a good one, Admiral. My name's Ted Kay, and I'm
an
old C4I guy from a long time ago.
All right.
But 963s, all that. So I'm going to take advantage of where your train of thought was going and bring it to...
Derail it.
Yeah, to battle orders.
Okay.
Trying to summarize it. And what I think I heard you talk to at various things, the last thing about the J3, Rick's comments also had me going as a trainer on a ship, is, okay, you write your battle orders, and you're trying to increase the situational awareness of the watchstanders and all the different aspects of their business for that watch or that night or for the whole operation you're doing. And in it, speaking for myself, I didn't capture all the little nuances. It was sort of like, don't get into trouble, don't handle whatever you're tasked, call me if you're necessary type of thing. But now we're talking about stuff like, well, I really want you to know what's going on in the spectrum. I really want you to know what's going on in the network, not only our own, but others as we're operating. I really want you to know and be able to ask watchstanders who are assigned that job what it is they can do if this particular situation presents themselves, what we expect. And you sort of write all that up in both from a standing orders to battle orders, and you really get to the nitpicking of this, and it turns out you're planning all of what their activities are going to be, and the byproduct of that is training, the knowing how the plant operates, the knowing what to do if you get a sonar contact, and what else. Okay, so that was the tough part.
With that scene, sir.
So that question is, how are we getting the operators, not only the Navy, but others, into the describing the problem and helping them achieve not only effectiveness, but also knowledge, as you were just talking about.
So I'll focus on what I try to do as U.S. Cyber Command, specifically, because I think I can give you more specificity there. So I spent a lot of time thinking, and again, this goes back to my early days as a surface guy. I go a lot of time thinking, how do I, as a commander, effectively articulate commander's intent and a framework for response in action in which my presence is not required, simplistically? So I'm going, hey, the answer can't be you gotta wait for Rogers. Boy, this is not gonna help us, you guys. So for us, I say, I want you to keep three touchstones in mind. Our success is predicated on speed, agility, and precision. You must be willing, and we must be capable of acting quickly. We must realize that we're working in an environment, in an emission set, in which change is the natural order of things. So you must be agile. Do not assume that a particular course of action is the one we're going to execute for weeks at a time. This ain't going to work for us. And then precision. I remind them, Latin long, that's how we define space in the terrestrial world. In the cyber world, position, location, simplistically, not always, but simplistically, defined by an internet protocol, an IP address. That IP address, depending on where it is, 10 to 15 digits precision. Said you get one digit wrong in that 15-digit sequence, hey, we're not in country X, we're in country A, and boy, we shouldn't be in country A, you guys. We gotta be very precise here. Then I also talked to them about, so let's walk through what should a response mechanism be. And again, this is framed by my experience with NMCI and the fight there, but also a couple actions I've had dealing with penetrations in my current job, where I've kind of told the team, and I apologize, I'm not going to go into the specifics because I don't want to have an opponent to get insight as to how we think, but I've sat down with the team and said, let me give you the broad operational construct that we need to default to. This is where I want you to start from, and you don't have to wait for me, that you can get started immediately. And so I've laid out, there's about five different steps. And I always think of them as skipper's night orders. You know, boom, boom, boom. Or fighting instructions. Hey, here's what we gotta do. And so we've done that. I also try to take advantage of every opportunity I can to expand the experience of the organization. So right now I will consciously at times, I might have assigned a mission to my Army component. In fact, we're doing this right now. And yet I will say, I want people from my Navy component, Coast Guard side, and the Air Force side, because I say, guys, this is a real world opportunity for us. There's a training opportunity here. And even though it's more people than you might need, it's gonna pay off for us in the future. You gotta spread experience across the force. We can't focus it in just one segment. You know, that was one of my takeaways from Operation Rolling Tide, which was what we called the response to the penetration of NMCI. It was such a fundamental changer for us both at Fleet Cyber and 10th Fleet, but I would argue one of my other tenets was always turn crisis into opportunity to the maximum extent we can. Don't let a good crisis go to waste. Use it as a vehicle to drive change. Because it is amazing what you will do when you are under pain versus what you won't do when you're not feeling pain, and it's all an intellectual exercise. But when you're in the middle of a fight and you're feeling that pain, you can make a really compelling case real quickly about, hey, this is why we need to make fundamental change. This is why we need to look differently at the way we do things. I take great pride as a naval officer that the United States Navy, as a result of that NMCI event, really stepped back and said, okay, what do we gotta do? Doesn't mean we solved all the problems. Didn't we, that simplistically we said to ourselves, well, we're through this. But we really stepped back and used it. What do we gotta do across the organization differently? What's the acquisition world's piece in all this? What do we gotta do in terms of training and education? What's the role of OPNAV in this? What's the role and expectation for second echelon commanders? Hey, it can't just be Fleet Cyber. What about PAC Fleet? What about Fleet Forces Command? I mean, we really sat down and said to ourselves, how do you fight and maneuver in this environment? Let's learn from this, which I just thought, hey, I'm proud to be part of an organization that's willing to learn. And that really, to let me conclude, to me, that is the power of the Naval Institute. It is amazing what we can learn when we're willing to challenge assumptions, look at alternative viewpoints, and articulate thoughts, ideas, and concepts, and to do so in writing. That is not an easy thing to do. It takes a lot of guts. There are men and women like Jim Stad Rivas who have done this throughout their entire professional uniform career, and they did it at an incredibly early age. I think you were first published as midshipman, Stad Rivas. That takes a lot of guts. As leaders, we have got to create a climate where our teammates understand, hey, we want that to happen. We want you to question. We want you to articulate alternative thought. And we don't want to hold this against you. Hey, I welcome people with alternative viewpoints on cyber. We're not always going to agree, but man, I want us to learn, and I want a dialogue. And the best way to learn is to actually sit down and challenge assumptions and think to ourselves, what do we got to do? Because if we think that we're going to achieve this by a linear extension of everything we've done in the past, I think we are doomed to failure. We got to ask ourselves both what applies from the past, because history can be a great teacher to us, as I said, not the first time we've had to deal with significant changes in assimilating disruptive technology. But at the same time, we got to say to ourselves, what's another way to look at the problem set? And so often, it is the younger, more junior. Because quite frankly, the older you get, the more the system has captured you. And I don't mean that necessarily in a terrible, evil way. I just mean the more your frame of reference, the more your horizon has tended to be shaped and molded. And the more junior you are, at times, the real advantage there is, hey, you often approach it with a much wider aperture. And it's our ability to bring those two things together, that's the sweet spot for us. And each of those elements got to recognize the value that the other brings to this. So thank you all very, very much for your time today. Thanks.
Admiral, we are so happy that you came here today to share your time. We're thrilled that you're a member. We're proud of what you're doing for the Navy, and it gives us all comfort to know what you're doing for the nation, for all of us. We'd like to have you have this Naval Institute book, Practice to Deceive, about military deception.
There you go.
Thank you.
Wow, man.
Okay, well, I thank everybody for coming out, and now we'll start our reception, which will be right behind you. Thank you very much.